Good morning, one and all. Welcome to day 5 session of the summer school on two-week summer school on machine and deep learning for remote sensing application. Today we have a resource person, Dr. Anil Kumar, scientist from IIRS Dehradun. Before proceeding the session, I'll give a brief introduction about Dr. Anil Kumar. And Dr. Anil Kumar, sir, going to talk about on theoretical aspect of deep learning in geospatial technology. So his brief biography as follows. Dr. Anil Kumar, sir, is currently scientist, SG, and head of the photometry and remote sensing department of Indian Institute of Remote Sensing, IIRS, ISRO, Dehradun. He received a BTech degree in civil engineering from IIT affiliated to University of Lucknow, India, and a ME and PhD degree in soft computing from Indian Institute of Technology, Roorkee, India. He has guided 8 PhD theses and 6 more are in progress. He has also guided several theses of M.Tech, MSc, B.Tech, postgraduate, diploma, etc. He has received Pisroth Rama Pisrothi Award for contributing state of the art fuzzy based algorithm for Earth observation data. His current research interest includes in the area of soft computing based machine learning for single date and temporal multi-sensor remote sensing data for a specific class identification and mapping through in-house development of SMIC tool. He also works in the area of digital photometry, GPS, LIDAR. Sir, very much love to work with his PhD research scholar and M.Tech master student for their research work, and he always motivates student to do a good research. So in this, I request Dr. Anil sir to start your session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Shyamlal ji, for nice words in the early morning, and thank you for inviting me, considering me to deliver a talk in this school 2 or 3 week session which is going on in your NIT Suratkal. Coming to my topic. And before topic, I would like to just brief about IIRS, which is one of the center of ISRO. IIRS basically is one of the unit located at Dehradun, Indian Institute of Remote Sensing. And this institute conducts M.Tech, MSc, PG diploma programs, M.Tech from Andhra University, Visakhapatnam, and MSc from ITC, Netherlands, with 20 university. We also conduct tailor-made user demand courses. So this is an academic and training institute. And today's topic, which is asked to me, is already displayed. That is theoretical aspects of deep learning in geospatial technology. Mainly here, I will focus on clustering, classification, detection, and further some in-house techniques what we have developed. So basically we will share our own experiences in this area of processing the remote sensing images for specific applications. If you talk about learning, which is a very common word nowadays, it is basically acquisition of knowledge or skills through studying, through experience, or being taught by somebody. So these are the different modes through which we learn, we get trained, and with this learning we can see the jargon words floating today. One is machine learning, then with coupled with deep learning, and on the top of these two learnings is very, very important, which we forget, is called human learning. So which comes through human engineering. That means if we develop ourselves, we can have very good models of machine and deep learning with us, working for us. machine learning, if you talk about, this is one of the application of basically artificial intelligence. So artificial intelligence domain uses so many different models so that the system can work by its own using its artificial approach of intelligence and making some decisions. So machine learning and deep learning is one of the domain which is part of artificial intelligence to process the data and extract very meaningful information. But if we see more realistic 2B AI tool, it should improve from experience without being explicitly, this is programmed. So every time we should not program to work. That AI tool or AI machine should be data driven. As per data given, it should give the solution. So every time the rules or decisions should not be provided to the machine. So that is the beauty where we have to bring it the AI tools. And nowadays you can see plenty of tools in the common life. We can see which is working for us on day-to-day basis. Overall, if you see these machine learning or deep learning, they follow the four concepts of learning. It can be supervised. That means we are providing the data, training data. And nowadays, if you see like Google Chatbox, so many, they are working to get the to get trained. And how they get trained, they are user driven. That means the user which is using and for its own purpose, and the moment he takes some action on that or query, that query or action becomes a learning to the algorithm. So they are data driven or they are user driven to learn. So user is providing the training data so that algorithm continuously goes on training himself to give the best output. So these are we require here the training data in the supervised mode. Unsupervised mode means we don't provide any training data. Algorithm iterates and calculate the parameters so that it can process the data for dividing into different groups or for prediction purpose. So here, main application of unsupervised learning is mainly in the remote sensing domain. If we have image of an area, so we want to know how many maximum number of classes are present in that area. So for that, we can apply unsupervised approach when we don't have the training data, sorry. Then third learning approach comes is semi-supervised. Semi-supervised means when we have small training data with labels and large untrained data without labels. So in that case, we can apply the semi-supervised approach. And fourth one is the reinforced learning. The reinforced learning basically train the algorithm with respect to rewards or punishment. Machine learning, if you see, it has very well established two areas where in the remote sensing domain we are using. One is for classification, that can be supervised or unsupervised, and second is for prediction. So in classification, for example, grouping the pixels, so we can create the thematic map. Here you can see these pixels are water, these pixels are for settlement, and these pixels are unclassified pixels. Or people are using the regression algorithms for prediction, tomorrow rain will occur or not. So these are the two very prominent applications of machine learning in remote sensing domain. With the remote sensing, with machine learning and deep learning concepts or AI tools, what we talk about, people think about there are limited algorithms. Specifically, there's a myth going on. The management group which are conducting the machine learning programs, they generally cover or include these algorithms as part of machine learning, which is support vector machine, random forest, decision tree, so forth. So these are three, four algorithms they think they are the only part of machine learning algorithm. That is not true. Today, machine learning algorithm is a big domain or umbrella which includes all the classification and regression algorithms under this domain and stamp them as machine learning algorithms. Starting, you can see with the C means algorithm, which is very basic one, can be used supervised or unsupervised. These are also called C means or K means. Then maximum likelihood classifier, then linear mixture model, support vector machine, random forest, decision tree, fuzzy classifiers, ANN, and other classification algorithms. All these algorithms comes under machine learning algorithm domain. Now, moving towards remote sensing images, we can have some aspects or issues we can find out, like the mixed pixel. In this case, you can see there are 3 pixels representing grass, 2 pixels representing water body, and these 4 pixels are partially representing water and grass. Question comes, what label should be given to them? So these are the mixed pixels because they are having 2 or more than 2 classes. So the answer is we can handle these pixels through a fuzzy approach, where output will be represented as 0 to 1 as a membership value from 0 to 1. Second issue in the remote sensing image, we can see the noisy pixels. Noisy pixels can be due to the sensor misbehavior, or on the ground there are some objects which may give you the noise. For example, if I am having a very high resolution image, there some of the like individual tree in a playground is a noise for me. I want to eliminate that. So due to the objects present on the ground and due to the relationship of the resolution of the image, we may get noisy pixels, that is unwanted classes also, we can say. So how to handle that? The answer is we can handle through correlation concept. We can create that, or we can add that information, that is correlation information, neighbor pixel correlation, through Markov random field or through local convolution method. So these are the two methods. In local convolution method, we apply some filter concept and we pick the neighbor pixel effect and we incorporate that to the center of the pixel, and we can remove this noise. There can be isolated pixels. For example, if I am preparing a map at 1:20,000 in remote sensing as one of the application to prepare thematic map. So here at 1:20,000, there is no meaning to represent one pixel as water body. It may be present there, but it is so small object, we have to eliminate them. And how to do that? Again, the answer is we can do it through Markov random field or local convolution method. So these are the two methods which can incorporate during classification. They can add the correlation information of the neighbor pixels, and they can eliminate the isolated pixels. Next issue comes, generally if you see all these machine learning algorithms what I've discussed, they assume that the separation between two classes is linear, then only they will give you the very good result. But this is not always the case. Number of times between two classes, there is non-linear separation here. So there is non-linear boundary, decision boundary, and how to process. So any of the algorithm will not give you the good results if there is non-linear separation between two classes in a given data. So what we can do, we can add the kernel concept. We can linearize the data. And what this kernel does, it takes the data to higher dimensionality, and there it also linearizes the data. So the data looks like this. So classes are linearly separable. Now it is easy to separate them and divide into groups. So here I've already told, for mixed pixels, we can handle through fuzzy set theory. Noisy pixels, we can handle through contextual approach, that is adding through contextual information through Markov random field or local convolution method, using the filter concept and picking the neighbor pixels, and their effect can be added to the center pixel. This contextual or correlation with the neighbor pixels, we can see, like if I go to Punjab, and in that state, every alternate house person, one person has gone to Canada. So if I am there, so my neighbors, at least one person has gone to Canada, and their effect comes to me also, and from my family will also try at least one person to go to Canada. So that is a neighbor effect. Same way, we can see the neighbor effect through contextual approach if we add this approach in the base classifier. So here you can see the contextual approach. This is the list 4 image, and we have went to field and the field photograph of this dam, near to this dam, we have taken the field photograph. And when we are processing through fuzzy output without contextual information, what we can see here, there is a road here, and this road is bounded with eucalyptus plantation, and there is a shadow, and the shadow is giving you feel like a water body, because this is complete images for water membership value. And here we get the membership value that they belongs to water. They are not actually belonging to water. And same way here, some white patches we see that indicates these are the water bodies. When we add the contextual information through Markov random field, now you can see that white patches along the road has been removed. And here also few patches of due to tall trees of eucalyptus plantation, there was shadow and that was mixing as shadow, as water has been removed. In MRF, in literature, there are two modes of MRF we can incorporate. One is through smoothing prior. It basically dissolves the boundary. That is its side effect we can see. And so here you can see the class is quite, the boundaries are dissolved. Here there was small water body, which is not appearing. You can see this is the water body, which is not appearing, more or less dissolved. And this one also dissolved, which is a small water body. But here in DA, discontinued adaptive prior, this takes care the boundary should not be dissolved. It preserves the boundary. So here you can see this water body still retained and edges are preserved. So we have to see the side effect of adding the contextual information. The smoothening effect on the output should be as minimum as possible. Here you can see the output through local convolution method. So we have experimented when there is no noise in the raw image, and we have taken the output for wheat class. So wherever there is white patch, that's wheat. But here when we have added intentional 1% noise, then we can see still the output is acceptable. When there is 5% noise, still the output is acceptable. So here we have added the noise through special local convolution method in MPCM, modified probabilistic C-mean classifier. That's a base classifier, and special local information method was used to add the local pixel effect through window approach. Next is non-linearity between classes. As I mentioned, we can handle through kernels. So we can add kernels in the base classifiers like fuzzy or statistical classifier. There we can add the kernel concept, and we can see in the output the non-linearity effect has been minimized. Then second thing in the remote sensing domain, the very basic problem, because the main application of using remote sensing images is to prepare thematic maps at level one. Level one means we are just mapping water body, forest, settlement, so forth. So there is no issue. But when we go for level two, level three classification, level two means within agriculture land with crop, we are trying to map where is wheat and where is mustard. So this wheat and mustard are the rabi crop, which are sown in November time and get harvested by April and May. So they, when we go for level two classification to map wheat and mustard separately, they will give you more or less same signature when I take the single date image. So same signature means they are giving spectral overlap, and you cannot distinguish wheat with mustard, and you cannot get the output at level two or level three. Level three means within wheat, we are mapping the fields which are affected due to disease. So all these things, they will give you spectral overlap, and how to tackle them? We can tackle them through temporal data. So in the remote sensing, the very one beauty is there is a temporal resolution. Every 5 days, every 10 days, we can get the next image of the same area. And that temporal information, we can use it to take care of the spectral overlap issues. So this is the spectral overlap you can see for between two classes. So they are more or less mingling up. So how to do that? So here you can see in the, if I incorporate the time domain, so this on x-axis, the time domain information going on, you can see initially the field is fallow, then small germination of the seed, then small plant, it is converted, then more growing the plant, and further it is going to be at the flowering stage, the milking stage, the seeds is formed and it is at the milking stage, and final harvesting of a particular crop. And if you see the spectral curve in the NDVI mode, you will see the curve will be like this. And this is a unique signature in time domain. So if you moving in the time domain, this side, you can see this is a unique signature. So if I incorporate the temporal data, we can map this specific crop, which is giving unique signature in the time domain. So within agriculture fields, mapping a specific crop at level 2 or at level 3. So that's the solution when we use the temporal data. And we can take care the spectral overlap between different existing crops. So it has very good application in crop insurance, specific crop mapping. Why we want to map specific crop? Because that is a base input for crop yield. How much is the yield of wheat in district at a district level? So it is only possible to know once we know how many fields were having wheat crop, and then we can multiply the unit yield of wheat by the total area what we have found out. So total area which is covered by wheat field in a given district is only possible when we can map the field, that wheat field, and going mapping at level 2 or level 3. So here, phenology information from temporal images is very, very important when we want to go for level 2, level 3, or level 4 mapping in the remote sensing domain. So here you can see one good live example we have explored last year about mapping the transplanted paddy fields at specific dates using a bi-sensor, or you can say here we have tried multi-sensor concept. Here you can see we have taken two images from Sentinel-2 data of 19th June and 29th of June at pre-transplantation stage. Transplantation of paddy has occurred on 8th of July. So here we did not got image from Sentinel-2. So we have used the image from Landsat 8, which is at 30 meter. And these are the images at 10 meter. And fourth image, we did not got in the optical domain because it was cloudy. July month is generally cloudy. So we have taken SAR image, which is capable to penetrate from Sentinel-1. So here you can see there is data from three different sensors. And you can integrate the data from three or more than three sensors. The advantage is they can, each sensor can provide you unique information and to get the final information of what we want. So when we have processed this data, it is possible to map the transplanted paddy fields at the field level. But still, we got one issue that a dry canal was also mapped as transplanted paddy field. So the question came, how to remove it? So what is happening here, the first two stages of images are basically a fallow. So this is your fallow field. This is with water. And third is with transplantation. And fourth is the transplanted paddy is further growing. Same for this river case. It was dry. It was wet due to rain and due to water came in the canal, the grass grown and grass is further growing. So it is giving more or less same signature like transplanted paddy fields. And that's why this is again one real example of spectral overlap. So how to handle that? What we have done in the same database, we have added one more image of 6th of March where all the fields were covered with wheat. Now, if you see the five cases, the first image was wheat. And for the dry canal, it was fallow field. So vector has changed. And now with five images, three from Sentinel-2 and one image from Landsat and one image from Sentinel-1, it was possible to remove that dry canal. It has been removed. So you can see this is a multi-sensor concept we have gone. And it is possible to remove this canal, which was overlapping with the transplanted paddy fields. So how we have done, we have used the CNN model first here with 128 and with 64 with max pooling and dropout and dense layer. And in the second, these are the optimized model parameter epoch with loss and epoch with accuracy. And we have also tried to add LSTM layer of RNN in CNN and to see how it behaves. So here you can see LSTM one layer and LSTM second layer here. Rest was more or less same. Still, we are able to get the output. When we have added LSTM with CNN, we did not got so much good accuracy compared to the independent CNN model. But nevertheless, we are just experimenting. Is it possible to add LSTM long short-term memory layer with CNN or not. It was possible, but we did not got good results. And we have concluded, that is one myth about deep learning concepts, that they require large training data, 60,000 images, 70,000. That is not always true. That depends upon what level of information we are extracting. When we want thematic map from remote sensing images, you can see here, we started with 20 samples, 20 pixels, then 30 pixels, 40, and then 50. At 50, we got the sufficient accuracy when we have used CNN or CNN with RNN model. Second live example, you can see for crop, for sunflower crop, Shahabad region, which is in Kurukshetra in Haryana. And sunflower crop is basically sown in Feb and March, and it get harvested in the month of May and June. So again, we have taken the temporal data, images from 21st March to 30th of April. And the objective was to map the sunflower crop field and further refine that objective, that can we map the at different sowing stage. So can we map the fields which were sown at different time? So the central data with the 2A and 2B, it is quite good enough that we can get the images every 5 days to 10 days interval. And what we have done, we have developed our own in-house approach called CBSI NDVI. So this is class-based sensor independent approach on NDVI. Advantage is the system will take care the bands selection for NDVI itself. We don't have to tell that this is my NIR band and this is red band. Second thing, it is not always to use red and NIR bands in NDVI number of times, because the bands are more nowadays, like in Central 2, you may have 10 to 12 bands. So it is not necessary that red and NIR can enhance maximum. If you take other band combination, they can enhance that crop much nicely than NIR and red. So that is the way the CBSI class-based sensor independent approach we have developed. So we don't have to define the bands in the NDVI. It takes by itself, and it will take the best date which can give the maximum enhancement of that class. So here you can see the output. We were able to map the early sown sunflower, middle sown, and the late sown. And from these informations, we can conclude, once we have the field level information, we can find out the cause why some fields were early sown, some were middle sown, and some were late sown. What are the social aspects or economical aspects of the farmers for sowing at different time? Second experiment in urban we have done, the importance of temporal images. Specifically, if you see in urban, at any data set, we try to map the built-up change detection. So up to built-up level, we do the change detection. We cannot pinpoint that the change is up to building level, but we have tried to map the building footprint level changes occurred in a given city. And here we have used again 10 meter spatial resolution data from Sentinel-2. So here the answer was, can we map this building footprint level changes? Like initially there was an open space, and that has been converted to building. So can we map that that change which has occurred in urban area? So we can find out in a given 6 year time where, which are the buildings which has came up in the last 6 years. So answer is yes. So what we have tried, we have used two date images. First date image of October 2013 from Landsat. We did not got from Central 2 because Central 2 came in 2015. And second image we got from Central 2 in October 2019. So we have kept the month should remain same. And what we have tried, we have applied the fuzzy based modified probabilistic C-mean machine learning algorithm. So here what we have done, this is Dehradun. So we know each and every pocket of Dehradun because I am already stationed to this IRS, which is in Dehradun. So we have taken this site, Baruwala colony, which has came up in the last 6 years as a training site. So we have trained our algorithm with Baruwala site and four sites, four pockets we have kept for testing, like Sabji Mandi of Dehradun, ISBT of Dehradun, surroundings of the Kalidas Road where our campus is, and Dun University. And we have tried to find out that does in this area some buildings has came up or not. So when we have tested the Kalidas region, you can see we have tested with NDVI of two date image The NDVI gives you the NDVI difference. NDVI has decreased or increased. It cannot pinpoint the building has came up or not. Same way, when we go for conventional change detection approach, we classify the two images and go for change post-classification change detection. Still, it cannot pinpoint up to building level changes occurred. But when we see through our approach, we were able to map on the Kalidas Road, the new apartment came called Shivalik Apartments A here. The Golden Jubilee Vikram Sarabhai Hostel in our campus, which was came in last 6 years here. And this is your C is your Golden Jubilee Hostel, which also came last 6 years, which was also able to map. Just outside our campus, one of the owner has converted on the top of roof, concrete roof, they have made the tin roof. So can we map that building? Yes. Can we map the Meridian apartment just near to our campus? Yes, which was came last 6 years. Then in Baruwala, which was a training site itself, there was large buildings were there. Can we map these buildings? Yes, we can map. And we have compared with the existing Google Earth image in 2019 and 2013. It was not there, these buildings, but in 19, these buildings came. So can we map these buildings? Yes, it was there. But when we see through NDVI approach, we cannot see the building level NDVI changes, or we cannot see these buildings through conventional post-classification change detection approach. Then we have done a study at Dune University. Dune University is quite old one, already completing 10 or 12 years, but still in this building last 6 years, we can see that two buildings has came up and which was nicely has been mapped, the approach what we have given. But through conventional change detection or through NDVI differences, we cannot make it out these buildings has came up or not. At Sabji Mandi area, a lot of apartments has came up and which was nicely mapped through this approach. This is the main Sabji Mandi area and surrounding to it, a lot of apartments has came up. Then at ISBT is a new ISBT in 2002 or 2003, it was shifted from main city somewhere here. This was the main ISBT, but surrounding to ISBT, in the last 6 years, we can see new malls, new government offices came up and which was possible to map. So here advantage is in the built up change detection through this approach, we can map the building footprint changes in last 6 years, which has been converted from open space to building footprints. Next, very common issue with any of the algorithm while processing remote sensing data is how to handle the heterogeneity within class. So here, if you see a dense forest, still it is not so homogeneous. There is some variation, right? So that variation gives you heterogeneity. If you see open space, it is somewhere it is moist, somewhere it is dry, small patches. So it is mingled up, and this gives you very very strong heterogeneity effect on a particular class when we process. So here you can see there are small patches within that open area and which will contribute a lot of heterogeneity when we are extracting this open area. So question comes how to deal that. If you see the conventional or machine learning algorithms today, they are if they are statistical based, they are using statistical parameters, specifically very common parameter is mean, right? So so in the existing statistical machine learning algorithm, they are using the main dominating parameter is mean, and which cannot basically take care this heterogeneity. Here you can understand if I take these many samples and using the samples, we extract the mean. So mean comes somewhere here. It does not truly represent to each sample, but what we have done, we have tried to incorporate individual sample as mean. We are not using mean as a statistical generated parameter. We are using individual sample as mean, and that has given the real ground impression on the algorithm. It is like in the COVID, I can give you the live example. Government says the death was 1% in a COVID wave 2, but that is statistical information that may be good at the India level, but when you see at ground individual house level, that does not have any meaning, because there in that house one or two or four deaths has occurred. So that 1% death, which is very small parameter, that does not have any meaning to a house. Same way here, when you generate the mean does not represent the actual ground truth data. But when we incorporate the actual ground truth data in the basic statistical algorithms like C-mean or MLC or fuzzy based algorithms, then you can really see they give you the impact and they really handle the heterogeneity within class. So here you can see what we have experimented to some of the areas, like we have done experiment on the Banasthali Vidyapeeth sites of the outskirts of it. There is a well-known girls school to university level campus. It is here with the airstrip. So surrounding to it, we have studied for three crops. One is mustard. So here, this was the test or training field. We have the ground information, and we have extracted this through individual samples. So when we have done it through individual samples, this was mapped as homogeneously, because if you go in winter time in the Rajasthan, you will see maximum fields are covered with, say, mustard. In the, suppose this was near to the Rajasthan towards Jaipur region. So there you will see the crops are totally filled by mustard crop. And in the time of starting January, you will see all these mustard fields are yellowish. Yellow blanket is seen because flowering is going on. It's really beautiful, and you can shoot a lot in that time. So here they're quite homogeneous, but still there is small variation. So that small variation has been neglected when we are using individual samples. But when the mean comes, when we are using here statistical parameter as mean in the classifier, you can see this field has not picked up as a homogeneous field. Still some heterogeneity effect is there. We have tested with grass that is within Banasthali campus. There is a cricket ground which has been picked up very nicely as a homogeneous field through individual sample approach. But when we are using statistical mean approach, this field is not homogeneous. There are some white dots. Then this, again, second playground has hardly picked up. But this playground, again, has been picked up very nicely. There is a parade ground in the same university. It has been picked up very nicely here. Partially, it has been picked up. Outside of that campus, hardly there are a lot of grasslands, but not picked up. But here, these grasslands has been picked up very nicely. So you can see the advantage of covering actual ground truth information through the machine learning when we use individual sample in the algorithm. We have experimented with wheat. So these are two wheat fields checked on the ground. They have came nicely. When we have checked through mean approach, they have not been picked up very nicely on the output. Now moving, so this I've given you flavor of machine learning. Now going towards deep learning. So deep learning is a modified version of artificial neural network. Till date, artificial neural network was a very advanced algorithm compared to the other machine learning algorithms. But today, when the deep learning concept is there, so artificial neural network has become a basic algorithm. So it has its scenario has changed with time. How the scenario changes with time, that is the one example. But the question comes, why to call deep? That is very, very important. To get the deep concept, it's not just by adding the number of layers. If you just add number of layers, you will not get the much deep learning effect on the algorithm. So model will not become deep learning behavior. But the deep learning generated a large number of features. So what it does, actually, if we are extracting large number of features, large number of characteristics of the object, then, and if we use that as a pre-processed output, which are in which we have extracted large number of features like color, shape, size, height, and so forth. So these parameters, when we extract in large number, that means the data dimensionality with respect to feature map has increased, and that gives you, and while adding the non-linearity in the data, that gives you the really deep learning effect as the model to be working as deep learning. So any model, it is extracting large number of features and adding non-linearity in the data, then that model, we can say it is a deep learning model. So these models, what they do, that's a plus point here. With learning algorithms, it can be from ANN to deep learning models like CNRN and so forth. These models does not generate statistical parameters. They take the sample data as it is. And that's why these models are fully capable to handle the heterogeneity. But these models are a little complicated. They consume little more processing time and hardware resources also. But I have given you one good example of how to handle heterogeneity with the statistical based classifier. There, if I use their sample as it is without generating the mean, if I use the sample as an individual sample as mean, then there also we can handle the heterogeneity very nicely. Advantage there is to tackle the heterogeneity, the models are, machine learning models are so simple compared to deep learning. Nevertheless, deep learning models has other advantages. They have very good applications of can be used for classification. We have experimented. I've shown you transplant paddy field, where we have used the model as 1D CN model. Then we can use it for detection. It's well known. Last few years, people have used, and you can see the output. People have used the deep learning models for detection purpose, and we can use them for image transformation. That means converting one image to another. Like if you have a lotus image, you can train the model, and from lotus image, you can generate the rose image. So that is a way the image transformation you can have. We have tried to remove the cloud in the temporal remote sensing data. A deep learning classification algorithm, if you see, these are CNN model, we can use it 1D, 2D, 3D, RNN, or in the form of LSTM or GRU, and their hybrid versions, we can use it for classification. They are mainly supervised classifiers. And you can see we have tried to compare with the fuzzy based classifier, FCM classifier, PCM classifier, ANN classifier, and then MPCM classifier. And here also we got CNN classification. When we compared all these outputs, we found CNN is quite homogeneous output compared to other outputs for a given input image. This was the Formosat image of east side of Haridwar. And we got in this output of CNN, the homogeneity was maintained. So it was dealing nicely the heterogeneity present within class, within each class. I was talking about transformation application of deep learning. So here you have one very good model, GAN, Generative Adversarial Neural Network of deep learning, which can remove the clouds from optical temporal data. So here, what we have done, we have taken one image of 27th of October of Patiala region, and second image of 30th of October. In 30th of October, there was partial cloud patches. Why we are doing it? Because we were working in Patiala region for extracting the burn paddy fields. And we found for 30th October image, it was cloudy partially. Can we remove that cloud? So then we thought to use Explore GAN. And this 27th October image was used as a true image. And that has been compared with the generated image by the generator. And discriminator is basically checking that generated image by generator. It is true image or false image. If it is false image, it will ask to regenerate. And that way, we got this image from this image. From this image, image is transformed here. So here you can see the small cloudy patches has been removed. Now this image, which is of 30th of October, became useful in the temporal data. So that way we can make the images to be useful once we remove the unwanted things from the image. So here you can see the basic model of GAN. So here you can have the real image, which is checked by the discriminator. And here the generator generates the false image or fake image, which is checked by the discriminator that is it is a true image or false image. You can see the pix to pix GAN we have used for generator to generate the false image. And discriminator, again, pix to pix GAN, we have used patch GAN discriminator architecture, where we can compare the generated image is equivalent to the true image or not. Then second, very good application of deep learning models are for detection purpose. And there are large number of models. It can start from RCN, faster RCN, then the one is fast RCN, then second is faster RCN, mask RCN, fused fully CN, XG boost, SSD called single shot detector, YOLO, you only looks once, and there is SPPNet and so forth. These are the models, and there are large number of other models which are designed in the literature for detection purpose. So here we have used the application of detection for building, and further we have used that information in a fuzzy based classifier. So one problem, if you specifically process the very high resolution images for detecting an object, you cannot do it by the conventional classifiers. You will get false classification like that. This road, ships may get classified to a building. So it was happening here also. So what we have done, we have applied here, suppose SSD, and we can get the bounding boxes. Using this bounding box information, we have applied this masking concept, and we have applied the fuzzy based classifier. So within the bounding box, the buildings has been extracted, and there was a road and there were ships here, which has been excluded from the input, from the output data. Then we have used it, the deep learning concept for detection purpose of brick links. So in a given image, can we count these brick links? So first we have done the detection using the bounding box. Then we have converted as a point data. So by this we can count, and we can also, we have experimented initially with SSD model, later on with the mask RCNN. And for of these brick links, can we get the coordinates so that later on we can geolocate them where these brick links are, because these brick links are unauthorized activity for making the bricks. And these one brick link run for around 2 months, and for 2 months time the bricks are ready to be used. But in 2 months time, it contribute a lot of harmful gases in the environment. So government can do some licensing, and once they know where these brick links are located. So nowadays, if we have images, it is possible to extract these information quickly in a very short span of time, and can be delivered to government. Then we have experimented for like hangars for aircraft. Can we identify these hangars? These are most less camouflaged. So yes, we can do that. This is, we have done through mask RCN, and we can have the geolocations later, and we can get the coordinates, let long information of these hangars. We are just doing it for UAV images for vegetable areas. But in the greenhouse, the vegetable has been grown like cauliflower, and the objective is, can we extract these cauliflower cauliflower plants or these weeds present in this area, so that we can estimate how much is the anti-weed chemical is required to dispose that. So here we have just tried with MPCM, and it's possible using the individual sample as mean, not just mean information, using individual sample as mean, because in the cauliflower, if you see, there is very high heterogeneity. Here the pigment is different, there is shadow on the leaf within due to the other leaves. This center part is giving very young leaves. So within the cauliflower, you can see very heterogeneity. You can see again shadow here, and somewhere you can see white lines, that is the veins of the leaf. So within cauliflower is very high heterogeneity, we can directly see on the raw image. So in the UAV images, we can see on the image itself, the heterogeneity is very, very large compared to the remote sensing image. So question comes, can we handle that? And yes, when we have used individual sample as mean, it is possible. We are further trying to use deep learning concept, initially masking, and then applying the fuzzy based algorithm. That means we are trying to localize the area through bounding box, and later on we are applying the fuzzy algorithm to extract. So that way the accuracy we may further improve. We are also trying to use segmented information and see its effect for extracting these type of objects. Again, you can see the individual cauliflower. Here we have tried, but I think few training samples here we missed, and that's why in these portions the membership value is not very large. It is not showing to be as a cauliflower. So here if we add few samples, this area can also be picked up by the algorithm very nicely. So that also we have done. Maybe we have to test only while appending the training data. So this is all about my side. Last year in the COVID time, we have published one book, Fuzzy Machine Learning Algorithm for Remote Sensing Image Classification, under CRC Press, Taylor and Francis. Thank you all for listening. And this book is available on different portals as a digital mode, as well as hard copy bound. It basically covers the full range of fuzzy algorithms with the CNN, RNN, with the real case studies related to agriculture, forestry, burn fields, and with in-house tool. Thank you all again.
Good. Thank you, sir. Thank you for delivering a wonderful session, which you give insight about the critical aspect of deep learning, various real application.